It gives me great pleasure to introduce the composer David Matthews. And David has written extensively for orchestra, including seven symphonies, and is currently at work on an eighth, and numerous vocal and chamber works. He worked as an assistant to Benjamin Britten between 1966 and 1970, making vocal scores and fair copies of scores, and for Owen Wingrave, among many other of Britten's substantial works, which we'll be talking about perhaps particularly in the afternoon session. He's also written extremely well-received and much-translated biography of Britten, and also one of Tippett, and writes regularly for journals and other publications. And a recent collection of these, along with contributions from other writers, was published for his 70th birthday last year. He's going to talk today about the musical language of the opera in relation to two particular sections, and looks like you're going to play something on the piano as well, and we'll hear something from the recording as well. And he's also going to refer to the chamber version of Owen Wingrave, which David arranged, which is the version that's being performed to great acclaim at Snape at the moment. David Matthews.
Well, thank you very much. It's very nice to be back in Aldeburgh again after quite a long time, and it's particularly nice that I'm staying at the Red House, and Yesterday I wandered through the rooms. It's amazing because they're exactly as they were when I first went there in the mid 60s. And the library has been restored to as it was when I first saw it. It gives you one extraordinary sense of ghosts, actually, I suppose. It's a bit Paramore-ish in some ways. Well, in 1970, when Britten finished the music of Owen Wingrave, I'd been working for 4 years as a part-time assistant to his main assistant, Rosamund Strode, spending several months each year in Aldeburgh, particularly in the period leading up to the festival, and working in my own office in the old stable buildings at the Red House, which are the buildings next to it, which are now part of the library complex. I'd come to this job without any real qualifications, not having studied music at university or at a music college, but I happened to be working as a freelance for the young company Faber Music at a time when Britten needed help in an emergency, and after that more extended help in copying scores, making vocal scores, and doing other editorial jobs. Since he didn't sack me, my work for him must have been satisfactory. I didn't know at the time, fortunately perhaps, that he could be very hard on those who failed to measure up to the high standards he demanded. I have to confess that at the time I was working for him, I was generally rather unhappy with the music he was then writing, feeling it was not up to the standard of his earlier work. I was particularly critical of The Prodigal Son. I made a rehearsal score, and I suppose the general opinion now is that it isn't quite as good as the other two church parables. It was composed when Britten was ill with endocarditis, and much of the writing was done under great strain and seems more dutiful than inspired. But Wingrave, which was my final task before my brother Colin took over from me, I made the vocal score and copied out the full score with Colin's help, as it was a rush job. Wingrave was different. It was the first time Britten had used an orchestra in an opera since A Midsummer Night's Dream 10 years before, and it was in many ways a return to the Britten I knew and loved. I went to the first orchestral rehearsal, orchestra alone without the singers, at Morley College on the 16th of November 1970, and I wrote in my journal, "The music, which in vocal score looks nothing at all, is astonishing. The sounds are constantly new and masterly. It's much better than any of the church parables. Individual moments stand out as exceptional. The music for Owen's first aria in Act One, strings and harp, reminiscent of Lucretia, with the same uncanny brooding quality. The Paramore interlude, long string lines and a heavy staccato bass, rather like the Passacaglia from Peter Grimes. Best of all, Owen's peace aria in Act Two, with its gamelan-like tuned percussion and soft wind and brass chords, and the anguish climax that follows. The expansiveness of the score is very welcome, much more like the old Britten, and there is much more harmonic movement than of late." I'm rather proud to have been the first person to write about the peace aria, which subsequently everyone has rightly praised as one of the great passages in all Britten. Unfortunately, I spoiled my enthusiasm by adding that I was bound to be disappointed when I heard the voices. And this was This was because I couldn't then accept the ending, where, as I saw it, Owen is arbitrarily and improbably killed by a ghost. I wanted Owen and Kate to be reconciled and the pair of them to leave the house together, putting all behind them and walk off into the sunset like the end... like the end of Yennefer. Well, I must say that I didn't understand properly then what Britten was doing, and that his opera must end as it does. I'll return to this later and try to show what Britten actually is intending and does very successfully. I can vividly remember the astonishing impact that the opening made on me when I first heard it. It seemed a completely new sound, as I think it is. I'm going to play the whole of this opening passage, which is very much designed as an accompaniment to what we see in the television production, a series of 10 Wingrave ancestral portraits, each accompanied by a solo instrument or instruments against a gradually accumulating and crescendoing tremolo chord on the strings and separated by the military percussion rhythm that we've heard at the start. The first thing to be said about the music of the opening is that until we reach Owen's horn theme at the end, most of the music is not tonal. In fact, it's really quite uncompromisingly atonal. It's based on a 12-note row. Britten has done this before in The Turn of the Screw and A Midsummer Night's Dream, for instance, but never quite so close here to Second Viennese School Expressionism. The row is spelled out in the three chords of the opening. This is the opening. So we have the three chords, and the same chord a semitone higher, and the last four notes. Now, the first two chords are what's called dominant sevenths. In other words, you can use them to modulate to B flat major. But Britten doesn't use the chord like that. It's what you might call a sound object. It contains what's called a diminished triad, as opposed to a minor triad. And the diminished triad is used throughout the series of portraits. In the first one, the bassoon theme is heard on the first, is based on the first chord, and then two notes from each of the second and third chords. So that you hear the first theme, of the first portrait, from the first. That's from the second chord, and then that's from the third chord. And then you hear on the next portrait is accompanied by the same theme in inversion, upside down. The diminished triad is used throughout the opera to symbolize the military tradition of the Wingrave family. The fifth portrait, accompanied by piccolo and trombone, is that of the sadistic colonel and his son, the young boy, whose death we'll hear about in the ballad that opens Act Two, and whose ghosts haunt the house and will be the cause of Owen's death. As we move through the portraits, the tremolo chord builds up note by note until by the time you reach the tenth and last portrait of Owen's father, there are 11 notes of the scale sounding together. They're introduced in this order. The 10th portrait is illustrated by what Philip Brett has called a violent parody of Viennese Klangfarben melody. We have this very angular theme. We've heard something like this before at the climax of the scherzo of the Sinfonia del Requiem, which is a vivid depiction of the horrors of war. Brett says, the 12-note element helps to create an atmosphere of ugly chromaticism signifying war and its corruption, for it may have seemed appropriate to Britten, whose attitude to Beethoven, Brahms, and Schoenberg was ambiguous to say the least, to symbolize an outworn family tradition in terms of what he most likely saw as an outworn European language. Well, I'm not sure whether he saw it as an outworn musical language, but certainly, using the language he does, Britten is able to make a powerful contrast between something he disapproves of and finds evil, the Wingrave military tradition, and Owen's pacifism, which he sees as entirely good. What a relief when the tremolo chord ends, with only its bottom note, A, still sounding, And A becomes the dominant of D, the missing note from the 11-note chord. And that resolves to a widespread D on the strings, and we hear Owen's theme. So we hear real triads, not diminished ones at first. Tonality is reborn. They're minor triads, but we hear not major ones. Owen is not destined to be wholly victorious in his struggle against his family, and the theme never rises above its third note, the A. It descends gradually into the lower depths, leading directly into the first scene in the military academy. Owen is going to make his stand, but what he stands against, war, will not go away. Well, I'll now play you the whole of this introduction in Britten's recording. The other passage I want to talk about is the duet between Owen and Kate at the end of Act Two. After Owen's peace aria, some of which we've heard, in which he has achieved a sense of great confidence in what he stands for and has, as he believes, successfully defied the spirit of his ancestral house paramour. The aria is accompanied by a succession of quiet triads, alternating major with minor. Remember that Owen's initial theme had only minor triads. Now we hear major ones too. Over these triads, the percussion float a gamelan music that symbolizes freedom and beauty. When at the end of this, Kate appears, she sings the same descending phrase that she'd sung at her first appearance in Act One, and accompanied by the flute, accompanied in the flute by the same melody, which is derived from Owen's horn theme, though with the last three notes turned up instead of down. This is Owen's theme, you remember, which ends like this. Notes. Now this is the theme, the flute theme, which is the same notes as Owen's theme, with the notes turned up. It's as if, as if she, perhaps there's some hope there that she might change him. And it emphasises the closeness of Owen and Kate when they were childhood sweethearts growing up together in the same house. Her Act One words when she first appears were, "How strange to abandon the dreams of our childhood." And now singing, "Ah, Owen, what shall I do?" to the same phrase, she tries to recapture that time. For the first time in the opera, appearing tender and compassionate, something that Janet Braker brings out so beautifully. As we've heard from Frances, Janet Braker found the role very unsympathetic. She told Britten how hard it was for her to play the role, and Britten was unrelenting. Of course he was, because it was absolutely necessary that Kate should engineer the climax of the opera by daring him to go into the haunted house, the haunted room. When they begin singing together, it does at first sound like a real love duet. And when Owen sings, "Kate, come with me, it's not too late," for a moment you might imagine my fanciful Yennefer-style ending is perhaps on the cards. But as he sings this, the C minor music, which has taken up Kate's descending phrase in plaintive major sevenths, is invaded by a motif consisting of two rising fourths, which then become more and more invasive. This motif is derived from Lechmere's exuberant outburst, "The Minstrel Boy, so the war is gone." The minstrel boy. We have these two fourths. And from the first scene of the opera, the rising fourth becomes a pervasive militaristic sign. So Philip's part is saturated with fourths. The mood quickly changes. Kate will have none of this. And when she says, "You're wrong. Everyone knows it. Even Lechmere, your friend, knows it," the rising fourth motive sounds powerfully on the timpani. Owen responds angrily. "How dare you scold me, coward that you are," Kate now sings, and the diminished triads return with her phrase. Coward that you are. Owen denies he's a coward. So Kate says, "Prove it, sleep in the haunted room." And we hear on the trumpet the rhythmic motive that is especially associated with Paramore and its ghosts. We've heard it in some of the music we've heard already, this one. Owen's reply to her, "I thought I'd done with that, with the Wingraves and the house, would you drag me back?" is accompanied by a shadowy reference to his piece aria. But he agrees to her challenge, and as Kate makes her final plea, "Say you'll be a soldier," the fourths here on B flat and E flat and A flat take over completely in the strings and the timpani. The whole music is pervaded by these fourths. Owen sings, "Come turn your key." Eight times a vocal phrase of his in this duet has begun or climaxed on a higher E flat. Now he rises triumphantly to E natural as he sings, "Come turn your key." And as he reaches the E, the orchestra come in with this huge chord. The chord is called the added sixth. It's a triad with the C major triad with the A added, so it's in the orchestra supply the C, G, A, and the And Owen adds the E and the trumpets and the trombones add the E.
It's a very powerful gesture. It sounds, as you'll hear, almost like the end of Schoenberg's Gurrelieder, which is the same call, the hymn to the sun. And it's also the same call that ends Das Lied von der Erde, mal das Lied von der Erde, which, as we know, obsessed Britten in the 1930s. He writes one most wonderful letter about it to his friend Henry Boies. Mahler's ecstatic acceptance of death through faith in the eternal beauty of nature is echoed here, as it was in later Britten works when we hear the same C major added sixth at the end of A Time There Was and at the end of Feeder, but not there with the same exultant power as in Wingrave. It's a blazing affirmation. It's one of the great moments in Britten's music. And this is what the opera's really about. It no longer matters that Owen is soon found dead. He's made here his great heroic gesture, not in battle, but for his pacifist beliefs. As he said, only in peace can I be free. So when I hear this scene in Britten's recording with Benjamin Luxon singing Owen and Janet Baker as Kate, at the end, very end, you'll hear a little fragment of Nigel Douglas as Lechmere.
Yeah. say, coward that you are.
That I'm not. Even you don't dare believe it.
How do I know?
You do know.
Then prove it.
Tell me what you want.
Prove it.
Some drunken officer's trick. Thrust my sword to my hand. Pin it to the table. To amuse the gaping ladies.
No.
What then?
No.
What then? With the Wingraves and the house, would you drag me back?
I see your brave heart fails you.
No, if that is your idea, I'll do it.
You won't last out the night.
Then lock me in. Okay, what childish airs are these? As if to sleep under that heartless roof. My word!
Why do you tremble like a boy the first time in the field?
Not fear, but passion makes me tremble. The anger of the world is locked up there. A horrible planet makes men fight. Now I alone must take it on. I must go in there.
I'll just end by saying a little bit about my chamber version, which I was asked to make in 2006 to be performed at the Royal Opera House's Lindbury Theatre. My first decision, of course, was how many instruments I could use. In Britten's three chamber operas, The Rape of Lucretia, Albert Herring, and The Turn of the Screw, he'd used an identical ensemble of wind quintet, one percussion, harp, piano, and string quartet with double bass. I based my own scoring on this ensemble, but straight away decided that I had to use a trumpet and trombone, as well as a horn. And because of the importance of the percussion part, especially in places like the Peace Aria with its gamelan sounds, I had to use two players and a rather large number of percussion instruments. Because of this, there was no room in the Lindbury pit for both piano and harp, so I chose piano, which could fill in for the missing brass. In the original score, there are two horns, two trumpets, two trombones, and tuba, and also play the harp part where it could. For these Aldeburgh performances where space is not an issue, Mark Wigglesworth has restored the harp part, which I'm very happy about. And so, for instance, we can hear its distinctive sound in the Act One meditation in the park, which, as I'd noticed at the first orchestral rehearsal, is similar music to the first scene of Lucretia and similarly scored. And the harp also plays an important part in the Peace Aria. Given the reduction of the wind and brass players from 15 to 7, I was surprised how closely I was still able to keep to the sound of the original. But more importantly, I think that in many ways, Owen Wingrave has more in common with the other chamber operas than with the big operas, Peter Grimes, Billy Budd, Gloriana. There's no chorus in Wingrave, for instance, except the boys who sing, partly help sing the ballad. And because it was originally devised for television where the characters would almost all the time be in close-up, there is an intimacy about the work that makes a smaller band with solo strings appropriate. In Wingrave, as later in Death in Venice, Britten makes quite sparing use of his tutti forces. When he does, as in the great moment of Owen's entering the haunted room, the impact is the more powerful for its restraint elsewhere. I have to say that was a moment when I wished I could have produced a more powerful sound. I did my best. What my arrangement has done, I'm pleased to say, is to have made Wingrave better known and better appreciated during the last few years, after quite a long period of neglect and underestimation of its worth. Thank you.
Thank you so much, David. That was wonderful insight into in such detail into two very, very powerful parts of the opera. We do have a few minutes for any questions, I think. If we have, do we still have Heather with a microphone? Brilliant. So if anyone has a question they would like to ask David. Yes, gentleman down here. Thank you. Oh, okay.
Every time you listen to that particular recording as opposed to the Channel 4 one or anything else, you realise how wonderfully exploited those particular voices. Did he write it with exactly those people in mind?
Oh yes, very much so. I mean, he always handpicked his casts. I mean, some people have complained that they're a bit old. I mean, Ben Luxon doesn't really look like a teenager, neither does Janet Baker. But it doesn't matter. I think the voices were the best he knew, and that's why that first recording is so good. It's flawless, really. Every single part is so beautifully sung.
Thank you. Anybody else have a question? Yes, gentlemen here.
Was there any thought given to the poor sound quality in television sets in those days? Because obviously it wasn't exactly
no.
Dolby surround sound in 1971.
No. Well, that was just something he had to put up with. Obviously, he would have preferred. He would have preferred. No, no, it didn't. I mean, you know, the recording was the is what we did have. We do have a good sound in the recording, but he couldn't have done anything about the television sound, and that was that.
Thank you. Anybody else? Yes. Oh, gentleman here. Chris, after you. Yes, then the other.
Although obviously, your arrangement is absolutely fantastic, it has meant more performances of the opera. Do you still think there is a lot to be gained from hearing the full version, some of that sort of luminosity of sound, and it's in some ways that it needs to be heard as well as Britten intended to get the full gamut of sound?
Yes, it does. I mean, I admit my version is a compromise, but all the same, I'm surprised. As I said, I'm surprised by how much I was able to keep to the original sound of the original. And here, I've noticed it, went to hear it yesterday, how extraordinary the Snape acoustic enhances the sound and makes it sound like a much bigger ensemble than it actually is. I actually haven't heard the orchestral version since the original performance, stage performance at Covent Garden in, 1971 or 1972, I can't remember it was. But it's been done so rarely that I haven't had the chance to hear it. I would love to hear it with the full orchestra in a smaller venue. I mean, it would be nice to hear that in Snape, too, and see what it sounded like. But yes, of course, I'm very pleased, as I said, that the chamber version does make it more possible to put it on. And as I said, it's also contributed to its revaluation. A lot of people are now talking about Owen Wingrave. They didn't. I mean, for a long time, Owen Wingrave was really the poor relation of all the Britten operas. People tend to dismiss it a bit. But it can't be dismissed. And
thank you. Thank you very much. Yeah. Was there another hand just there? Yes.
Well, you played the duet with Benjamin Luxon and Janet Baker.
Yes.
I enjoyed that particular part of the opera last night and today. Did Janet Baker and Benjamin Luxon worked together on any other operas, either by Britten or by other composers?
Not that I can remember. Does anyone know?
I ask the audience, lady.
Oh, yes. Oh, thanks.
Thank you.
Oh, no. Perfect.
Thank you. Great. Yes.
Yeah.
Right.
Yes, I believe that's right.
Who did Benjamin Luxon play in Lucretia? Can you remember?
Yes, I believe
so. The Little Britain peers kind of huddle here. We're just sort of going through the cast list. Yes, yeah. So it looks as if, yes, they did perform together. Thank you very much. One more question then, and we will have to go gentleman here. Yes.
Did Britten, when you were working on it, did he talk about a stage version?
No, he didn't. No. Well, he didn't to me anyway. But he didn't really ever say much to me about what he was doing. I mean, he didn't like, as I soon learned, he didn't like talking about his music. He was very reticent about it. I mean, you know, you could say nice things to him about it, and he was obviously pleased. He needed reassurance, as I learned. And it's quite extraordinary how much reassurance he did need. Even, you know, he had so little, in some ways, he had so little confidence. Well, it was a complete mixture, because he obviously did have confidence in what he was doing when he was writing it, but afterwards he thought, you know, he really needed people to tell him that it was okay. But no, he didn't talk about this. But he obviously did know that it must have, its future was going to be on the stage. He didn't want it just to be done for television.
Thank you very much. There will be time to ask David other questions later on, because he's participating in our panels after lunch. But for now, I'd just like to say thank you very much once again.
Thank you.